You can just write prerequisites of symbols. It's fine for the topic this week. Prerequisites of symbols. Okay, children learning a language. Do children learn a language from just listening? Listening to people talk? No. Certainly, listening to people talk is an important part, but it is much more than just listening. Again, an example, let's learn some Spanish real quickly. Un beso para ti. 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 Now, we can do that for 1,000 years, and you will never learn what it means. You will be able to say un beso para ti very well because of the coordination between our phonological system and our laryngeal system, but you will not have any understanding of what un beso para ti means. Now, if I did this, for example, un, 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 beso, beso, un beso, un beso, un beso para ti, para ti, un beso para ti. So, what is un? One or a. Yeah, un. What is beso? Kiss. What is para ti? For you. Great. So you see how, yes, we can be listening, but the only way for us to understand something is that it has to be coordinated with the physical body, with the physical experience, for it to gain meaning. Again, I hope you're all taking really good notes. Looks like there are some good students in this class. So think about this, that we do not learn by just listening. I can talk all I want. You have to have a physical experience. It has to be a physical experience for us to be able to understand, for something to gain meaning. These are the necessities for symbolic meaning. And if you have trouble seeing, move up. Okay, we've got some empty spots, you guys. Can't see. Move closer. These are the necessities for symbolic meaning. Just write them down. Constraint. I know you do not understand. I have been learning about constraint for many years. I still don't understand very well. It's really difficult. Try to explain a little bit today, and you will not understand. But maybe a little bit more. So we have constraint. Constraint is a necessary characteristic of everything. Constraint is a physical characteristic of everything in the world. Physical grounding. This means that all meaning is physical. Meaning or understanding is always a physical event that is part of you. It is not outside of you in regards to some magical, that you understand something magically. Your understanding is always a physical event. Again, think about physics. You guys know physics, like physics class? Okay, meaning is physical. It is connected to physics, connected to chemistry. It's related to physics and chemistry, and of course, together we get biology, right? Embodiment. Embodiment, you can see in here the word body. Embodiment means a physical body. You must have a physical body for understanding. Even now, some people, they think that we can have a tube with a brain. Okay, here's my brain. We can have a tube with a brain inside, and that there can be a mind. There can be a mind inside that brain. Not true. Your mind is not just in your brain. Okay? You need a body. Body is necessary for understanding, for knowledge, for understanding the world, for language. For example, one example for embodiment is, keep writing. In the world, most all cultures and civilizations now and in history have had counting systems, right? On a dual set, whatever, okay? Most all systems work in counting units of what? What are their big, we have units of one, and usually we have these subsets of what? Of how many? Any idea?
Ten.
Exactly. Almost all cultures, almost all civilizations now and all the way back into history. Why? Why 10? Ten fingers. Okay, the body helps define our systems of knowledge, our systems of language. Another example might be, help us understand things. This is probably Damon because he has a big nose. Don't laugh. All right. Where is the future? A, B, or C?
C.
Where is the past?
A.
Where is the present?
B.
Okay. Of course that is not true, right? That's not real. But for us to understand time, the concept of time, we actually understand the concept of time through our body. And so we create a metaphor that is connected with our body that, my body is here, there is the future. The future is coming to me. Here is the present, there is the past. That is true for most all cultures, not all. There is one culture in South America, they actually thought that the future is behind you. Why? Because you can't see the future. Exactly. They had a different metaphor for their concept of time, which is interesting. Not common, most all, but interesting. Okay, and that one sustains itself. So that's an idea of embodiment, is that we need a physical body for us to understand the world and to create knowledge of it. Situatedness. This is just a fancy word. Most Americans don't know this word, or at least in this way. Situatedness means that we must be in an environment. We must be in an environment, we must be in a context. And this is often a shared environment, shared context. Again, think about last week. Do you understand Yu-Gi-Oh? When I say Yu-Gi-Oh, which is just a symbol, you understand Yu-Gi-Oh? Because you have all been in the environment and the context, that cultural context. My friend I'm talking to on the phone, I say Yu-Gi-Oh equals Confucianism. He says, I understand. Does he really understand?
No.
Not really. Very shallow understanding, not a deep understanding. So, for symbolic meaning, we must have situatedness. We must be situated in an environment, in a context, in the world. It's required, it's necessary. And sociability, we talked about last week. Sociability, right? Babies are innate, naturally inclined towards social interaction. If we were not social, we would never be able to coordinate and organize our symbols, much less our cultures, our civilization, etc. This is a motivation to communicate. And some of you, you talked about parents talking in your notes from last week before. You talked about parents talk a lot. Who talks more in the classroom? Who talks more at home, parents or children?
Parents.
The evidence shows that parents talk more. They put microphones in the house for 3 years in like 200 different houses. We put microphones in each room for 3 years. In 200, we found that yes, parents talk more generally speaking. Who initiates more conversations. Initiate means start. Who starts more conversations, children or parents?
Parents.
Children. More than, well over 50% of all conversations are started by children, are initiated by children. Children have an innate sociability. They are very highly social creatures. They want to communicate, they want to interact, even before language. It is necessary. So, I will try to define for you constraint. This is very, very, very difficult to do. Can anyone see an image? Can anyone see something? A what? Tree? Leaves? No, but good. It'll be a 3D image. It will be very clear. If you see it, it will be very clear. Can anyone see it? It'll be really clear. You will not be thinking, oh, is that, should be a penguin. Really? That's cool if you can. That's amazing. But it'll be really clear. I mean, like, you'll be like, oh yeah, definitely. Okay. It's not just a little. It'll be real. Okay. So, if you can't see it here, no problem. I can't see it. I've never been able to see it. My brain is not, I'm just not smart enough, I guess. Okay, I've had a few students. All right, so there is too much right here. There is too much noise. Think about your TV. When you change to a channel, there is no channel, right? And it's just shh. That is noise. Okay, there's too much noise. If there is too much noise, then there is no constraint. Constraint is constraint. Things are kind of held together, pulled together. This is a marker. Okay? There's enough constraint. Here, there was not enough constraint. You could not see. You could not identify something. Constraint is really difficult to understand. Constraint is a characteristic of everything. Okay. What color am I pointing at?
Pink.
Red. Someone say pink? All right. Maybe. Okay, red. Okay. What color am I pointing at?
Yellow.
Okay. What color am I pointing at?
Green.
Okay. What color am I pointing at?
Orange.
Okay. What color am I pointing at?
Orange.
Okay. What color am I pointing at?
Orange.
Okay. What color am I pointing at?
Lime.
Okay. So this is an example of constraint. There is constraint. This is red. We agree. This is yellow. This is green. This is orange, or this is orange. Okay, we agree. There is constraint. A constraint is that things are kind of close enough or held together tight enough that we can make a category. That we can say, oh, this is this. This is an atom. This is a cell. This is Damon. This is red. But remember that these constraints and these categories are not clear. Is this orange, or is this green, or is this yellow? What about this? These categories, these constraints, they are real. They are real. It is constrained enough. For example, I had my students write the letter A in my previous class. Okay, students wrote A. Oh, I'm sorry, actually, what letter is this?
A.
Good.
A.
Okay, are they all the same?
A.
They're not all the same. Each one is different. A little bit. So my point here is that there is constraint. They are similar enough that when you look at them, you say, oh, A, that is a constraint. But notice that they are not exactly the same. For example, Damon. I am Damon. You agree?
Yes.
Thank you. So, I am Damon. This is a constraint. Now, at the same time, though, right now I'm rubbing off thousands of skin cells, maybe even millions. In fact, if you come back to class in 22 days, all of your skin cells will be completely different in 22 days from today. All of your skin cells will be completely different. But I will say, I am Damon. Even though my skin is completely different. My spleen, I don't remember what spleen, does anyone know spleen, what spleen is? I forget what spleen is. Spleen, bijang.
Bijang?
My bijang replaces all of the cells every 48 hours. My spleen is a completely different spleen every 48 hours in regards to the cells. But still I say, oh, my spleen. That is a constraint. Because I can say spleen, bijang. Okay, that is a constraint. It is stable enough that we can say, oh, I am Damon. But at the same time though, where does Damon stop? Where am I? It's not clear. Okay? It's not easy. Oh, where does red stop and yellow and orange start? Where is the boundary? It's not clear. And this is connected to knowledge. Because red, is this red? Yes, that's knowledge. Is this yellow? Yes. So it is connected to knowledge. We have constraints, but at the same time though, it's not clear. It's not always very clear. I know this is difficult. Don't worry, just write your notes. Just any questions you have, write it down. So, do you see a little bit of movement, a little bit of motion?
Yes.
Really?
Yes.
Is it moving a little bit?
Yes.
Really?
Yes.
No? A little motion to it. But yeah, but in a way, it's kind of moving. How about here? Do you see any waves?
Ooh.
Kind of like a wave, kind of going up and down through the line, through the arrows? Yeah? Do you see any black dots?
Yes.
Where are the black dots?
Does
it change?
Yes.
Ooh.
Kind of difficult to look at, yeah?
Yeah?
You kind of want to close your eyes a little bit, right? So, constraints are real. Constraints are difficult with the boundaries. Okay, where it stops right is. Also, it's always changing. And the reason why these illusions, why they work, is because we understand how our visual cortex, our visual system works, and we can then create illusions. The reason why the illusion works is because your brain is always, right now, constantly in action. Your brain is constantly in action. So we can create illusions that kind of trick our brain. Just because the brain is always in action. Things are always changing. Always changing. Our brain is changing every second, a little bit. Keep this in mind. Certainly, there are constraints. They are real, but they are also changing. Okay. For example, the way that we write the letter A was different 600 years ago. It was A, but it was different. Okay? It's constantly changing. It's not easy to see where the boundaries are. It is very action-oriented. I'm sorry you can't see the bottom. I can't fix it for some reason. You guys think, I have to look at those illusions for five classes. My mind is messed up. All right, so we're looking at here a semiotic network, what's called a semiotic network by Luke Steels. Do you know semiotic or semiotics?
No.
Semiotics is the study of how symbols gain meaning. How does a symbol have meaning? Really interesting. Here, in his triangle, he uses the word concept. I disagree. I think he should use the word schema. I like schema better. So, we have a concept, or we have here a schema. Let's take, for example, an object. I'll use the marker, for example. This marker, can you see the marker?
Yeah.
Okay, I can see it also. If you feel it, you touch it, you can feel it. Also, it has a smell, not very good smell. Also, this marker is also found within a context, usually. Which context, Gyosho or Norita?
Gyosho.
Okay. So there's even a normal context that is associated with the marker as well. So we have the object. The object has physical properties. We develop a schema that is connected to that object because of our body, through our body. Huh. I can see it, I can touch it, I can smell it, I can use it. So the object and our schema are connected together through our body. Sensor motor conceptual understanding. Sensor motor schema. Can you guess sensor?
Sensor.
Senses, five senses. Sight, taste, touch, smell, hearing. Sensor motor. Motor, remember motor from last week? Our motor cortex, our premotor cortex for moving. So we have our senses connected with our actions, sensor motor schema becomes through the experience becomes connected with the object, through our experience with the object. Okay, become associated together. And this can then couple itself with shared symbols. So then these, the object and the concept, are connected together, and then these become connected with a symbol. Our schema, our body-based schema, can become connected together with a symbol. For example, this says object, that says symbol. Lemon. Now, this is not a real lemon, this is just an image of a lemon, right? We could bring a lemon into class. I could give you a lemon, I could give you a lemon, I could cut that lemon open, we could smell that lemon, we could taste that lemon, bite into it. It's a little sour. Yeah? Lemon. Yeah, lemon. Lemon. A lemon. There are no right now. I bet that your mouth has a little more water in it than it did 5 seconds ago, or 10 seconds ago. Yes?
Yes.
That is there is no lemon in this classroom. No lemon. There's an image of a lemon here, which is connected with our visual system, of course. We even have here a symbol that then becomes connected with our schema, with our body-based schema. I said lemon, and you're like, right? You're like, sour. Okay, so the symbols can be connected with the schema. A concept, and again, remember, concept is basically schema. A schema is a concept, is a clustering, and think about constraint, cluster, is a clustering, i.e. categorization or constraint, of sensor motor experience. Let's think about a lemon. What kind of sensorimotor experience do you have with a lemon? Can you touch a lemon?
Yes,
you can touch a lemon. Okay, so you can touch a lemon. What else? You can smell a lemon. What else?
Taste.
You can taste a lemon. Anything else? You can see a lemon. Okay, so we can see a lemon, you can touch a lemon, you can taste a lemon, you can smell a lemon. I know I can. Also though, I mean, which, if I say, which one do you more closely associate with lemon? Summer or winter?
Summer.
Summer. Well, not winter. You don't eat lemons during winter. What, so there's kind of even a context. For example, do you associate lemons more with drinking or more with studying?
Drinking.
So there's again even like this kind of this context that gets associated with lemon. So we have the touch, the taste, the context that it occurs in. Okay, and these, the seeing it, the tasting it, the touching it, the smelling it, these become all connected together in a clustering, okay? And that's a sensorimotor experience. That is your concept. That is your schema. That is the schema of lemon. Not of the symbol. That symbol, can you see the symbol lemon?
Yes.
Here, can you see the symbols that make the symbol lemon?
Yeah.
Okay, you can see that. So here is sight, but then we also have the sight of this symbol. Can you also hear the auditory of when I say lemon, lemon? That is a phonetic symbol, so that's a phonological sound. So now we have a sound is connected together with a sight of this symbol. And this sound is also, just so you know, it's connected with our productive system, which is called our laryngeal and subglottal system, connected with our respiratory system. So we also have this set of sensorimotor. This is sight. This is hearing. This is sound production. These are also connected together, and that these is just a symbol. Could be agaba, lemon, agaba. Okay, I don't know, agaba, whatever, it doesn't matter. That these then can then become connected together with this real schema from tasting a lemon, smelling a lemon, touching a lemon, the context that it happens in. Now, this is, when I say lemon, this is the category of lemon. It becomes connected together. This is what symbolic acquisition is, basically. Of course, it depends on your experience. These associations, these growing associations. What is this? What is this? What is this? This is also an apple. This is a red, delicious apple. This is a Granny Smith apple. This is, I don't know, either Fiji or Braeburn. I think Fiji. Red, delicious, very delicious. Granny Smith, a little sour, but I still like it. Fiji apple or Braeburn, both delicious. I really like Fiji apples. This is called a golden delicious apple. Okay? It is very delicious. Has anyone had a golden delicious before? Oh, you have? Oh, okay. Now, All of you have a schema of apple because when I said, what is this? Is this an apple? You're like, yeah, apple. You have a schema that has been connected together with a set of symbols. Okay, apple. All right. Now, you have not eaten a golden delicious apple. If I bring a golden delicious, some golden delicious apples to you, and I give you all some golden delicious apples, does your schema change?
Yes.
Yes. You have a new experience. A lot or a little?
A lot.
Probably a little. Probably not a lot. You've eaten many apples in your life, and this will bring us to my next point. You have eaten many apples in your life.
Yes.
I bring you a new apple that you have not had before. It will change your schema of apple. It's a new experience. Remember, our system is always changing, all the time, a little bit. Do you think that if let's imagine you have eaten two apples in your life, okay? You've eaten two apples, I give you a golden delicious. Does that change? Okay, two people. Person A, person B. Person A has had two apples in their life. I give that person a golden delicious apple. It changes them, their schema, some, okay? Person B has had 499 apples in their life. I give them a golden delicious. It also changes their schema. Whose schema is changed more?
A.
A. Right? Because that person's having their third apple, right, versus somebody who has 499 apples, is that early on, our schemas are much more influenced by experience. This is why I think elementary school teachers much more important than middle school teachers. Elementary school teachers much, much, much more important than high school teachers. Elementary school teachers are much, 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 much more important than university teachers. It's because early on, your schemas are much more influenced by your experiences. This is why I think parents are much more important than teachers. All of you had great parents. That's why you're here right now. One of the biggest reasons is because you had great parents. And this relates to how do children learn. I asked you last week, I said, why? Why do children learn so quickly? Why do children learn so well? Any ideas why? Not because parents are always talking. That's important. Okay. Great. They do have... Yes. Good. Excellent. This is a very big simplification, okay? This is a neuron. This is a neuron, 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 whatever. Neuron, neuron. Okay. Our neurons are connected together through synaptic connections, synapse, okay? Of course, it's more difficult than that. They're connected together by axons and dendrites, etc. But they're connected together by synapse, 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 synapse. Okay. Now, when a child is born, the child has the largest number of neurons and synaptic connections when they are born. We are not growing our brains as we become older. Children, when we learn, we are not growing our brain, even though we like to use that metaphor. What happens is that we have the largest number, the most number of neurons and synapses, and then when we have experiences, learning, the connections become stronger, and some connections become weaker. So yes, Why do children learn so quickly is because they have fewer schema, fewer experiences. These connections have not been strengthened as much or weakened as much. Now, when we then want to learn something new as old guy, like Damon, old boy, is it easier or more difficult? More difficult because my connections have weakened or strengthened so much. When we learn something new, this has to become weaker or stronger, or this has to become stronger or weaker, and it's already kind of happened in the past. It's called, if you guys think about like fossil, right? We call it actually fossilization. Is that when we become older, these things become kind of more fossilized. They don't change as quickly. Whereas in children have high rates of plasticity. So, again, what is a symbol? A symbol is grounded in the world through our physical body. A beach. I shouldn't say beach. The physical thing. We have our sensorimotor experience, our schema of being at the beach or experiencing the beach or seeing the beach. And then that then gets connected together with a symbol. A random symbol. Could be adaga. Adaga. I had a great time yesterday at the adaga. Just a random symbol ends up getting connected together with a sensorimotor experience within a context, right? Situated within a context, a shared context. So symbols become neurologically, again, remember how we have these different experiences, they all become connected together, strengthening, weakening between the synapse. As an extension, hormonally, remember last week we talked about how our brain is very connected to our endocrine, our hormonal system, okay? Associated with concepts, here the concepts are in the schema. Of course, McDonald's knows this. They understand this. They use this understanding in their advertising, in their marketing. Think about, has anyone walked past McDonald's recently? What do you smell when you walk past McDonald's?
French fries.
They are not blowing that out the back, they're blowing it out the front, where the sidewalk is. So when you are walking past and you see the yellow arch, you are smelling something that makes you hungry at the same time. There's a reason why they do that, right? They're very smart. I encourage you to take notes. All of us have our own schema. We are all separate. We are not connected together by wires. We all, each individual has her or his own independent conceptual network. We all have our own schema. My schema is different than your schema. Did you eat the same apple as me? No. That's disgusting. There are similarities among the individual networks resulting from biological similarities. Are we similar? How many fingers do you have?
10.
Right on. How many hands do you have?
2.
How many noses?
1.
How many feet?
2.
Do you have a tongue?
Yes.
Do you have an ear?
Yes.
Do you have 2 ears? All right. So we are very biologically similar. So we are all separate. We are all individual. We are all independent. But we do have biological similarities. Of course, all of you are more biologically similar than you are to me, because you're all Korean, ethnically Korean. But we all have similarities of embodiment of our bodies, similarities of our bodies, and of situatedness. You understand Yu-Gi-Oh! Because you have all experienced the cultural experience of Yu-Gi-Oh! So you can understand Yu-Gi-Oh! I understand it, because I have also experienced it, not as much as you, My friend I talked to on the phone, he doesn't exactly understand because he has never been situated within that environment, in that context. Each network is unique, given differences in biological development and life experiences. Each network. All of our schemas are unique because we've all had different developmental, we have differences in our biological development because our DNA is all slightly different. If our DNA was all the same, we'd probably all look the same. So we do have differences, and we also have differences in our life experiences. I have been, has everyone been to a beach?
Yes.
Great. We all gone to the same beaches?
No.
No. Come visit me in Oregon sometime. That's my where I'm from, Oregonju. We have that beautiful beaches. Like Jeju. The network is continuously undergoing dynamic change depending upon experience within and interaction with the world. Again, when you were looking at those images, at those illusions, that's the reason why you could see black dots. The reason why you had trouble looking at two sets of eyes is because our system is always in action, constantly in action. Right now, your mind is changing constantly. A little bit. If it changed too much, there would be too much noise, and you would not have a mind. If Damon's skin changed too fast, I would fall apart, right? Sorry. You can write it in your own words, you can shorten it. We got about a 10-minute late start. I am going to go. Do you guys have a class at noon? Oh. No. Okay, I'm going to go 10 minutes late. You can copy off of other people, shorten it. Okay, so how is it that these symbols become organized? How is it these symbols become coordinated, especially in young children? Because young children learn so quickly. We think that it comes through language games. Now, language games, when I say game, this is very different from video game, very different from Kai Bai Bo game, okay? This is a very simple game, such as in Korea, you do a game, mothers and fathers do a game with their kids. Go, 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 kui. Go 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 nin, go 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 it, right?
Yeah.
That is a language game. What we are doing is we are associating an experience, touching of the nose, the feeling, the sensor motor, the senses, sensor motor experience of touching that nose with a sound, symbol, random symbol, ko could be ki. Ki, 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 okay? Could be any symbol. Go, 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 go. And then we also do another one. And the baby is copying that game, or maybe the mother is holding the baby's hand, touching the baby's finger. And again, think back to last week, how we understand other people's actions through our own actions, right? And the baby is smiling and interacting. This is how we think. This is the foundation. This is the basis for all language, for all knowledge, for our civilization and our culture to grow. Again, related to, we have to have that sociability. We have tested this theory using robots. This is not real. This is not real. But we are using it to test a theory. Okay, we're using it to say, hey, does this support the theory or does this discredit the theory? And we're going to find that this supports the theory. And again, you can see that that in this case they were using color. We have constraints. We have the constraints of the environment, of the situation. We have interaction. What these robots do is they go something like this. You're a robot. Okay? And... I'm a robot, and they program it, they'll And then you, she will go. Go like that. And then point at it. Point. Point at it. Point at it. Da-da. Handphone. Oh. Okay. So these robots, they engage in these kind of random games. And they end up, over time, they coordinate their color categories. They coordinate their color categories over time, over many interactions, naturally. Which again, color is an example of knowledge. Color is an example of knowledge. What color is this? That's knowledge. And again, the big part here is that we need to be social. We need to be human. We need to engage in interaction with our body, within a context, within an environment. This is a real conversation that came from the study I talked about where they put the microphones in the homes. And here's a mother. And the mother says, oh, now we're nearly dressed. Okay, now, over your head. Good boy. Put in your other hand. Put in your hand. Put in your other hand. Now, shoes. Where are your shoes? And the baby says, the child says, shoes. Yes, your shoes. Where are they? And they both look around. Oh, there, look, your shoes on the chair. Shoes. Yes, shoes. Now, does this, again, like we said before, parents do more talking, okay? Does this child understand most of what she is saying? Does this child understand most of what the mother is saying?
No.
Probably not. This child's like, soup. Right? Maybe, I don't know, but probably this child's not understanding everything, and that's okay. This was recorded a long time ago. I am sure, I am confident this child speaks English fluently now. So we just have a lot of interaction. How could this child doesn't understand over your head, but how will this child be able to understand these symbols? Just a symbol. Over your head. These symbols together, over your head. How can the child understand that? How can that have any meaning? Okay, within this context, the child is, she's putting a sweater over his head as she says it. He's like, oh, here, over your head, your hand, now your other hand, put it through. Okay, now your other hand. Okay, so my point here is just that the child doesn't know everything, that's okay. We're just interacting with language, we are doing things together. This child over time will learn the language. Now also, let's notice, the child says, Sus, is the child's pronunciation good or bad? Not very good. Yeah? Does the mother say, no, you stupid child, give me your hand? Slaps his hand when the child says, Sus? No. Let's think about children learning. All of you learned to walk. When babies are learning to walk, do babies fall down a lot? All the time. Failure, 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 failure. Now let's imagine we have a baby and we put on that baby an electric collar, shock collar. So when the baby makes a mistake, we shock the baby. Okay? Every time that baby falls down or tries to stand and fails, we shock the baby. Okay? Do you think that baby is going to learn to walk? What is that baby going to do? It's going to sit down and it's not going to try. Because it's punished every time that it tries to do something. And it fails. And all of you learned to walk. But you had to fail many times to learn to walk. The failure is part of the process of the learning. If you can do it, that's not learning. If you can do it, that's not learning. You already know it. If you can't do it, you have to fail as you're trying to do it. So think about school. Think about parents. Parents are like, oh yeah, shoes. Yeah, shoes. We model the appropriate language. We model the appropriate behavior within the context. But we don't punish the child for failure, for mistakes. Oh. I'm almost finished. Parents, they take the opportunity that is presented. Like I said earlier, parents talk more, but children start more conversations. Children initiate more conversations. And parents are responsive. Parents respond. Let's look at this conversation. Now, Mark is a child. Mark is looking out the window. Mark says, look at that, birds, mommy. So Mark is initiating the conversation. Mark says, look at that, birds, mommy. Mother says, hmm? Mark says, birds. Now, was she paying attention to the same thing that Mark was? No, she wasn't. Look at that, birds. Maybe she's like, huh? Maybe she's doing something else. She's like, oh, hmm? Birds. And she says, oh, what are they doing? Mark says, birds, bread. Mother says, oh, look, they're eating berries, aren't they? Mark says, yeah, that's their food. They have berries for dinner. Mark says, oh, what were the birds eating?
Berries.
Berries. Was Mark correct?
No.
No, he was not correct. Again, did the mother say, no, you stupid little child? They're eating berries, they're not eating bread. Do you need glasses? Okay. She corrects him, she models it, she corrects him, but without telling him that she's correcting him. He says, oh, look, they're eating berries. And he's like, oh, yeah. And she says, that's their food, they have berries. So what she does is she goes to where the child is. She is doing something else. She is responsive to the child, to where the child is directing the attention. The child says bird's bread. Why did the child say bird's bread? The birds are eating something. Maybe in his schema, he associates eating with bread, maybe. Or maybe he's seen birds eating bread in the past, maybe. I don't know. Okay. She is responsive to him. She models appropriate language. She talks and says, oh, look, they're eating berries. And then she knows where his attention is. His attention is here. So she goes to his attention and she then grows. She extends the learning opportunity. She says, oh, that's their food, berries. They have berries for dinner. So again, you can think about Vygotsky and Vygotsky's ZPD. ZPD, the zone of proximal development, is that we go to where the child is, we follow their attention, and then we then expand from there. Naturally, like a parent. We are responsive, we learn where they are. And again, this kid, he's not correct. He's just trying. The struggle to communicate is most important for language acquisition. It's the struggle, not the success. It's the struggle. Excellent. 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 Birds, bread. Birds, bread. Which one sounds better? Birds, bread, or bread, birds? Birds, bread, or bread, birds? Birds, bread sounds better. Why? This is a natural way that we construct our understanding of something and action upon something. Birds eat bread. This is, just so you know, this is the beginning of grammar. Okay, it's a very natural thing that you don't have to teach. We'll stop there. Well, actually, no, we won't. Because again, just think about what we're talking about, how we talked about the schemas and the way the schemas become connected together. Okay? Previous examples, parents made connections. Parents are making connections between different schemas. Okay, between sounds and actions and objects to create meaning within context. Think about how this relates back to symbols. Symbolic acquisition, symbolic coordination. Okay, we have a life connection, learning opportunity. Traits of parents and interactions. You don't need to write this if your paper's already full, but this is important. Parents ask questions and provide the answers. I find myself, I do this all the time with my son. I'll ask him a question, and then I even just give the answer as well. Because if he knows the answer, that's not learning. If he doesn't know the answer, then I need to model the answer. Parents are responsive to cues children provide as to what they're able to. Parents are responsible to children. It's not that we are always trying to make children come to us, it's that we go to the children. Think about this as teachers. Parents take what a child says and extends it. Think about as a teacher. The teacher takes what the child says and extends it. When the children are talking, it shows us where they are, what their level is, what their ability is, what they are thinking about. We go to where they are and we extend it. Think about a teacher. Teachers don't do this, usually. Teachers are trying to bring children to them. Oh, children should know this. Children should